because we are kings and our words matter. What is a believer? A believer is one in whom the spirit has now been quickened again. The spirit is now ruling again. A believer should be like Apostle Paul. A believer should not be saying, my body is the thing that is causing me to sin. The believer should say, I bring my body under subjection.
My foes are many, they rise against me. But I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. My help is.
True, my God will come through always.
If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. All things have become new. So the spirit is brand new. It's connected with God. The mind, the soul is being made new every day by the word of God. It's being renewed and made new every day. So the spirit is already new. The mind is becoming new day by day. The body still remains the same for a believer. Same means what? Still the fallen body. Still the body of sin. That's why the Bible, like we read last week from the earlier verses, it calls it the body of sin. Spirit is new. The mind is being made new. The body is a fallen body. It's a body of sin. Body is not redeemed. Body is waiting for its redemption. When Jesus shall appear, corruption shall put on incorruption. Right? That's when it will be changed. So spirit and soul are changed and being changed, but the body still remains in the same condition. So where do you think the problem is for the believer now? The believer, the spirit is new, is a new creation. He loves God, he thrives on God and the things of God. The mind, if he is very renewed in his mind, he's a very spiritual person. But still, he's got a body to deal with. Sin taking occasion by the flesh tries to comes in. It knows how the root. Oh, believe me. Sin knows the root, how to get in. Sin knows that it must get through the body into that person. If sin wants to get into me or you, it knows the root. It must come through the body, through the lust of the flesh. It must come because this body is still the same. It's still filled with those same things, and it must come. Now, let me say this ahead of time. Paul says in another place, he says, I bring my body under subjection. Have you ever read that? I bring my body under subjection. Now here is a believer. He realizes where the problem is. He knows the spirit is new, the mind is being made new, but the body has the problem. So therefore every day he's got to bring the body under subjection. He knows the route that the sin takes. When sin wants to enter in, it enters through the body, through the lusts of the body. So he says, I bring my body under subjection now. So this is the believer's position now. Now let me explain to you how sin really works through the body. I was reading a book some time ago about a man who had a wonderful big ministry and had a fall into sin. Somewhere along the time that he was doing his ministry, when he was at its very peak, he committed a sin of adultery. It's just a matter of half an hour, and the guy lost everything, lost his ministry, lost everything, actually ended up in jail and came out and all of that. Pretty good person and did a very dynamic ministry, huge, huge ministry, and a very good preacher and all of that, and very capable person. But that one problem did him in. And I used to, in my student days, watch him on television a lot. So I was very interested how this happened to such a great guy, you know, because I really liked him. And I had sympathies for him. Even after that fall, I sympathized with him and I wanted to see him well. So when he wrote a book, I read the book. And there he explains how it happened. He says he got hooked up with a girl just for one day, you know. Somehow they were involved in something. They were all staying in a hotel. And he came to know her and he just went up to her room. He said, I climbed up the stairs to go to her room and something inside of me said, don't do it. As I was climbing up, something inside of me said loud and clear, don't do it. Don't you do it. It's wrong. Don't do it. But my body said, do it. This is your last chance. I don't know what else it said, but I think it would have said a lot of things. You're getting old. If you don't get it now, when are you going to get it? You know. Look at you. This is the last chance. Have your last fling or something like that. You know, you know, sin can be very mean sometimes. It take advantage, occasioned by the flesh. As he was climbing, he said there was a battle between his spirit inside of him, saying, no, don't do it. And the body saying, yes, I want it. I somehow want it, just this one time, I just want it. And he said, the only mistake I made was, I said yes to my body instead of my spirit. And I ended up in a mess. I actually ended up in jail and all of that, you know. Not for this, but this brought to light some other problems and all that. And he ended up in jail and so on. Suffered very much. But the thing is this, how did sin work? See, I'm not trying to tell about that person. I'm just trying to draw a lesson for all of us, because we're all human beings just like him, you know. We're not here to just look at him and say, you know, he made the mistake. But no, it is all a lesson to us. How did sin work? That's how it works in everybody. That's how it works in a believer. It's a very classic example of how it works in a believer. It gets in through the body, through the lusts of the flesh. The body says, I want it. His leg wouldn't stop, he says. The leg keeps climbing. While the heart says, don't. But the leg is fast. It's just jumping and springing up and excited, you know. Because the flesh. That's how it works. It's a very clear example of how a believer gets into sin. Now, loosen up a little bit, you know, don't. Everybody's got so stiff, you know, they want to look like, you know, let's just sit up straight and look straight and, you know, nobody should think that he's talking about me, you know. Well, that's a good idea always, you know. When you get to a part of preaching where it looks like, you know, going to get you in trouble, just sit up straight and smile as if your preacher is talking to someone else. Some big sinners are here and he's talking to that old sinner, you know. Praise God, he's talking some good message, you know. When you get home, you lock your doors and get in and cry before God. And I understand. I will not catch you. For a while I wondered if I was the only person understanding this. But then, you see, a lot of people say this, you know, they say, you're so absolutely right, brother. That's exactly what happens to all of us. We're all just humans, just like that brother. Sin takes occasion by the flesh and gets in, and we're done, because in this world, that's the way it is. The body of sin, this fallen body, this Adamic nature, you know, that's part of this body, gets us always in trouble, you know. As long as we're in this world, we're in trouble. We fall many times like this because that's the reason, you know. Because God has left us still in this body, that's why we have such difficulty with sin. They justify their sinful behavior pointing out to the body. Now, I want to clear this matter, because nobody should justify their sin. We are not saying these things so that we can justify our sin, saying that the body is the same as sinful body and that's what is causing us to sin. No, I'm drawing a lesson from here. What is a believer? A believer is one in whom the spirit has now been quickened again. The spirit is now ruling again. A believer should be like Apostle Paul. A believer should not be saying, my body is the thing that is causing me to sin. The believer should say, I bring my body under subjection. There should be no excuse. We can't simply say, it made me sin. Sin made me sin. Sin's power got me. Sin's power is too overwhelming, too powerful. It got me. That's nonsense. Sin's power is not too overwhelming. It's not too much, because the power of the Lord Jesus who lives in you, the Holy Spirit who lives in you, is greater than the power of sin. You take a stand against it, the Holy Ghost takes a hold with you as your helper. If you don't take a stand against it, then the Holy Ghost has nothing to stand with you on. You got to make the stand. You got to make the decision. You got to say, in Jesus' name, with the help of God, I'm going to say no to this. And the Holy Spirit says, that's right, boy, I come and stand with you. Don't worry, I am your helper. I will see you through. You see? So nobody has to give that as an excuse, you know, that because of the body of sin, because of this world and the sinful nature in the body and all of that, that's why I sinned, you know, sin's power is too much. No, that is all nonsense, you know. The Bible clearly says in chapter 6 itself, we read it in so many places, particularly verse 12, it says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body. Very clear. Don't let it reign. That means you don't have to let it reign. Otherwise, he wouldn't have said, don't let it reign. He said, therefore, let not sin. Don't let it. If you let it, it'll reign, but don't let it. You don't have to let it. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lusts thereof. By obeying the lusts of the flesh, you are allowing sin to reign in the body. Don't let sin reign in your body by allowing the lusts of the flesh reign through your body. So Paul is very clear. So nobody can really make this an excuse, you know, and say, well, sin really got me. Like one fellow said, it's a glandular problem, he said. I said, oh yeah, glandular problem. That's what the Bible says, he says. Yeah, the Bible also says a lot of other things. He says, don't let the lust thereof rule through the glands thereof. That's what it's saying, you know. You got a decision to make. You are under control. You see, Bible teaching really puts you on a high level. You know, you are made in the image and likeness of God. You got to make the decision. You are a person. You can decide. You can think. You can make a decision, and the Holy Spirit will be the helper. There is nothing so powerful that it will overwhelm the Holy Spirit, right? Some people also say, well, brother, I'm a believer, but I have wrong desires. Some people come with great worries, you know. I have wrong desires. Sometimes these wrong desires come over. They're so worried about it. And I always ask them, do you get only the wrong desires, or do you have some other feelings also come with it? I said, yeah, I get the wrong desires, but at the same time, I get a big strong feeling inside my heart that it's wrong. I said, then don't worry, you are a believer. That's why you're getting the feeling that it's wrong. There are two voices. One is saying, the wrong thing is fine, let's do it. And the other is saying, don't do it. That's because you are a believer. When you were a sinner, you sinned without choice. You were a slave to sin. Read Romans chapter 7. I don't have the time to read it, but let me give you the reference. You can read the passage. Verses 17 all the way to 25, you read it. Or 14 to 25, you can read. Paul talks about a man who's not saved, and his position with reference to sin. What is he like? He says, the thing that I want to do, I'm unable to do. Have you ever been in that position? Once again, you're acting like you don't know anything. It's all right. I understand. The thing that I want to do, that I can't do, he says. He says, I understand the laws of God. The Ten Commandments are good. They're holy, and I want to do it. I'm a religious person. As a Pharisee, I'd like to do it. I'd like to live by it. But the thing is, I am not able to do it. I want to do it. I realize it's good, but I'm not able to do it. That's a slave. Won't you say so? The guy wants to do it, but his will is hindered. He cannot even act with free will. One of the things that the Bible teaches about will is that a sinner does not have a free will. His will is under the power of the enemy. Only when you are saved is your will free. Now you can sin or not sin. You're truly free now. So Paul says, the thing that I want to do, I'm not able to do. The thing that I don't want to do, that I end up doing. That's a classic case of a sinner. I'm a slave, he says. I found out why. Why am I not able to do the things that I want to do and end up doing what I don't want to do? Why? He says, I found that sin resides in my body. There is no good thing in me. In my body, there is no good thing. Sin is residing in my body. That's why I'm like this. He identified the location where the problem is. I'm body ruled. I'm a slave to my body and its lust, and the mind and its lust. That's the way I'm living, he says. Who shall deliver me from this body of death, he says. And then he says, thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who causes me to triumph. That's what he says. You see, this is the story of a sinner. When you go to chapter 8, if you go to Romans chapter 8, look at verse 10. Talks about a believer. He says, if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. Ah, very important statement. Look at this. If Christ is in you, he's talking about the believer. See, chapter 8 begins with a description of a believer. Therefore, there is now no condemnation to them which are in Christ, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit, and so on. The law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. Romans 8, 1 and 2. That's how it begins. It describes the believer. And then he goes with a further description and then comes to verse 10. He says, if Christ be in you, he's talking about a believer. If Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin. In other words, the body is a sinful body because of sin. The body is not alive to God. The body is still full of the old sinful lust. It's dead because of sin. But the spirit is life because of righteousness. Look at the believer now. The believer is like this. The spirit is alive because of righteousness. The body is dead because of sin. In other words, the body, when it comes to the things of God, doing the things of God, it is very slow. It is dead. It doesn't respond very well because it wants to do the wrong things. It is dominated by the lusts of the flesh. It's dead because of sin. The spirit, when it comes to the things of God, it's alive because of righteousness, right? And then look at verse 11. He says, but if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. He says, if the spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he'll quicken your mortal bodies. A lot of people have taken this to mean that at the end, after we are dead and buried, one day God will raise us up from the grave. Well, for that, there's a lot of other verses. We don't need this verse. This verse is talking about the body and how the spirit affects the body. If the spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he will quicken the body. In other words, here is the body that is still a body of sin, affected by the lusts of the flesh and trying to draw you away into sin. That's the condition of the body as a believer. But your spirit is alive unto God, and the spirit of God dwells in you. And if that is true, he will quicken your body also. In other words, by the spirit, now you can mortify the deeds of the flesh. By the spirit, you can take control of the body. By the spirit, you can dominate the body. By the spirit, you can now rule over the body. If the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he will quicken your mortal body. This sinful body can be quickened, can be affected by the spirit of God that is in you, and you can live a life for God. That's what it's saying. So, we are not under sin's dominion. So, think likewise, he says. Likewise, reckon yourselves. Think likewise. Then secondly, he says, even though we are not under the dominion of sin, sin tries to enter through the body, but we are in a position to take control of the body and bring the body under subjection like Paul, that he has taught. And therefore, he says in verse 11, likewise, you reckon. You begin to think like that. You begin to think that sin has no dominion over you. You begin to think that even though it tries to enter through the body, you are now in a position to bring to subjection the body. And then thirdly, he says, sin can never make us slaves again.
At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away.
Where I first saw the light.